Calvary Baptist Church, we're so glad to have you here this morning, and we're glad to have everyone joining us online as well. It is 32 degrees in Wisconsin, Hartford, Wisconsin. It's 34 in Denver, and it's 47 in Calvary, Georgia. Aren't you glad you're in Calvary, Georgia? Amen? Amen. We don't have any snow on the horizon, right, Tap? No snow? Melissa, no snow on the horizon?
Thankfully not,
is exactly right. But we're glad to have you guys here, and I'm glad you all came out. You can tell how cold it gets because you see how the preacher dresses. You know, as it gets warmer, I won't wear a suit coat as often, okay? Or maybe a tie, but as it gets colder, everything comes on, all right? And it's always a good time there. But we're glad to have you here this morning. The choir's got a number to start us off with. This No Other Name.
Oh,
going to ask Brother Paul Boyette if he'd come and open us in a word of prayer this morning. And we want to remember those that have lost their loved ones this past week. I believe it helped me out. Joyce Hayes and Jerry Hayes lost a cousin in an auto accident. And Jim and, is it Carolyn Hardy?
Yeah.
They lost, Carolyn lost her, was it her mom?
Mom.
Her mom. So we want to lift them up in prayer. Paul, would you mind praying for them?
Yes, sir.
Praying for the service.
Can you please bow your head? Lord, thanks for bringing us here today. Let's keep these people in mind in our hearts as we go through the season here. Just lift them up in our prayers. Lord, let us get something out of the lesson today and further your will on earth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And amen.
You may be seated. Are we going to sing Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone?
Tremendous job, and I'm putting Candy on the spot. She has no idea she was coming up front. Why don't you share The first option care stuff that you have. You want your notes?
Okay. First option. We are having a drop-in baby shower. And like I do everything, I have to do everything twice. I like to sew, but I have to take it, rip it apart, and sew it again. I like to cook, and sometimes I have to do the recipe over again. So it says here on the in the bulletin, March 3rd.
And I made the mistake.
You made it?
I did.
Aw.
I'm sorry.
Thanks. Taking the blame. But it is March 2nd. It's on a Thursday evening at 6:30 at the regular women's meeting, but it's a drop-in shower. So you can come by and get some snacks for Women Fix. We'll have a cake. There's also a Moses basket in the back of the church, or is that the front of the church?
It's at the back.
It's at the back.
We can put it in the river.
I never know if that's a... But the back of the church, there's a basket. You can drop your gift if you can't make the drop-in Thursday, March 2nd. And we also included a list here of things we need. And thank you to Leah Moore. She did a complete inventory last Monday of what we have and what we need. So you can thank Leah. But this is a list of suggested items, things we need. Okay? That's it. Yeah. Thank you so much.
You did so much better than I would. You did so much better than I would. That's amazing. That's good. Wednesday night.
Family night something.
Miss Edie, tell us about it.
Wednesday night, 6:30. Good supper. Day after Valentine's, so we'll have a Valentine's theme. We're having lasagna, salad, bread, and a yummy dessert.
Amen. And
we're going to... Make sure you fill out the form in the bulletin. Let us know you're coming.
Yes, fill out the form. Let them know you're coming. We want to honor our widows and our widowers as well. And we'll do that evening also. So you come on out and enjoy. Just don't wear anything white, especially if you eat lasagna like you eat spaghetti and you get it on the people next to you. Make sure they're not wearing white as well, okay? But we'll be doing that on Wednesday night. Then on Tuesday, before, just in a couple of days, we have our men's prayer breakfast at Cracker Barrel in town at 7 p.m. at the Cracker Barrel. We'd love to have you come. You all heading to work? And Brother Bill?
7 a.m.
7 a.m. Did I say p.m.?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm sorry. It's 7 a.m. And Brother Bill's going to be speaking, so he wants you to be there 12 hours earlier than 12 hours later.
We'll be talking about the four-letter word, love.
Amen. So Brother Bill will have that opportunity, and it's just a wonderful time. It is a wonderful time. You get to meet men from the community in Tallahassee, and it's just a tremendous blessing. Then we've got the youth camp trip coming up to Word of Life Tampa. I tell you what, if you want to check out what they're going to be doing, some of you would want to sign up. It is going to be a blast for them. They're going to be leaving on Friday of the, what is that, the 24th? And, or is it the 23rd? Is that the 23rd? 24th, okay. They'll be leaving on Friday, going down to just north of Tampa, Florida, Word of Life, and oh my word, it is amazing. We would have all-nighters with our youth in Grace Baptist Church in, Bellevue, Florida, is where we were at, and we'd have all-nighters in Orlando, and Word of Life would sponsor them, and we would be going running go-karts one for a certain hour, then bowling for another 4 hours, and some other games, and by that time, the youth leaders are all in their buses and in their vans sleeping while everybody else is watching the kids have a great time. Then the kids get in the van and head on home, and they're sleeping, and the driver's trying to stay awake on their way home. But if you're signed up, kids, if you're signed up for it, you are going to miss a tremendous little bit of fun in your life if you don't go. So be praying for them as well. All right, I'm going to ask the men to come forward for the morning gifts of tithes and offerings. And I don't know whose turn is it is to pray. I don't see any. They kind of alternate, so I don't remember who's
with.
But Johnny, why don't you pray since it's on there? Go ahead.
Gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank you and praise you for this time of worship in our service, Lord. We just thank you for your love for Calvary Baptist Church. We thank you for this time of year, Lord, that we can express our love to others, Lord, and know that we care and we love and we appreciate people, Lord. And we ask you, Lord, just to help us all as we try to honor and praise and love you. Lord, just be with Pastor Rob this morning as he brings a message to us. Bless the song services. Bless everything we do today to help us to honor you and praise you and thank you for what you do for us. Be with the ones that are not able to be here today for one reason or another, Lord. We pray that you'll bless them and help them, Lord, to know that we're thinking about them. And Lord, be with the ones that's lost loved ones. We ask you to bless them and be with them this week, Lord, and comfort and be with them in a special way. Thank you, Lord, for your grace and your mercy. Be with us this morning as we take this offering, Lord. Bless the gift and the giver, and we pray it all in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen.
I don't know if I turned it on.
Having some strokes. Is he right there right now, brother? He is. Let's go to Lord in prayer. Let's pray and lift him up in prayer. Father, we think of Lynn right now as she's probably at the hospital with her dad. Father, I pray that you might just lift them up and give the doctors wisdom, discernment, guide them as they lead and work on his health. Father, I pray that you just put your loving hand of protection and comfort there, and may your healing hand touch them today. Strengthen them, Lord, and we'll praise you for what you're going to do. In Jesus' name, amen. Miss Sherry, come on back.
Today, and what does it look like we might be having with these things? Like a birthday party, you think? Happy birthday? Yeah, it's going to be a birthday party. But I brought them because I wanted to talk about the birthday party that we celebrate like the start of the church. And that is called the Day of Pentecost. And so I'm going to use these things to help tell you about Pentecost. Okay. First of all, every birthday party usually has balloons. Now, is this how you hang up the balloons?
No.
What's going on? What's this balloon need? It needs some air to fill it up so it looks pretty. Instrument. Uh-oh. I did not try this before I left the house. Uh-oh. Okay, just a minute. Okay, there it goes. I let my children play with the balloons, my grandchildren, and I think somebody must have blown it up and then put it back in my drawer, and I think it must have stuck together or whatever. Okay, so anyway, here's the balloon. It looks prettier now, doesn't it? Well, on the day of Pentecost, they were all gathered, the followers were all gathered in one room, all together. And this is what happened. Ready? There was air that just filled up the whole room. And I'm sorry about that coffee breath. I am so sorry. Anyway, there was air that just filled up the whole room. And they were just like in shock, but it's kind of like the Holy Spirit came down and filled up that whole room and filled their hearts up too. Well, then there was something else. When we have a birthday party, we put these on the cake, right? And then, like, this is not complete. What does it need? It needs to be lit, and there needs to be fire on each one of them. Well, what happened is fire separated, and on each person, there was a flame. On each person that was in that room. So you got that big old air rushing in, and then you got the flames that are on them, and then they start talking in all kind of languages, languages they didn't even know before. And people were understanding them. It was the day of Pentecost. It was the day the Holy Spirit came down. Jesus had promised it, and it came down. Now, no birthday present is complete without these gifts. So there are some gifts that we got, all of us got, his followers and us, because we're followers, on the day of Pentecost. And these are the gifts. What does that say? Love. We were filled with love. Our hearts were filled with love. What is that big old long word? Forgiveness. Forgiveness. We are forgiven for our sins. We are forgiven. And then, so important. New life. Because the Holy Spirit came down, we have new life. So you've got God the Father, you've got God the Son, who is Jesus, and you've got the Holy Spirit. And the day the Holy Spirit came was Pentecost. Now, I just didn't make up that story. It's in the Bible. Acts 2, 1 through 4. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, we thank you for sending the Holy Spirit. Help us to remember that the Holy Spirit still fills the church with power today, just as he did on the day of Pentecost. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We're going to get ready for our next song, but I forgot something. He's going to cue it up. This is the first cottage in the Philippines that they've finished. Francisco sent it, and he wanted us to see this first cottage. Is there another picture there? Yeah, okay, good. So it's not finished totally. You can see the electrical wires hanging down inside there. But this is the idea they like to have there. And I've got maybe six of them you'd like to get built. And on the property there, the campground property, and look at that dot, he's even planting some plants. All right, so what a blessing that is. And continue to pray for the work in the Philippines. Pray for Jeffrey and Sydney. They did make it back from the river trip. And what a blessing that we haven't heard anything about that yet from them. But continue to pray for them on the Amazon River. I believe at this time we've got a special song by Betty Bird.
Everything gonna be alright.
Anyways, take your Bibles, turn to Acts chapter 2, if you would. Acts chapter 2. A number of years ago, we went to school in a one-room schoolhouse. Our Christian school, Waukesha Christian Academy, went up through the eighth grade. And we had the same teacher from fifth through eighth grade. Okay, how many of you went to school in a one-room schoolhouse? Raise your hand. All right. Yeah, I did too, but it wasn't. We didn't have outhouses, but we played football in the wintertime in Wisconsin. I loved it. I had these big gloves. We get out there and this hard football that was plastic. Okay, and it was awesome seeing that football go through the air and catching it for a touchdown and all the other good stuff and trying to go up and down the hill at Waukesha Christian Academy. Great time. I had a teacher there named Ted Cockett. Ted Cockett, he's in glory today. But we would do some music during whatever Bible class it was, and we'd sing these songs that were kind of fun because they were new songs, all right? And they had a little bit of a rhythm to them, okay? And that was kind of bad. All right, but one of them was the Holy Spirit came at Pentecost, all right? And I don't know if you're familiar with that song. The Holy Spirit came at Pentecost. Have y'all heard that one? Besides just what I just sang? Okay. Anyway, it was fun. It was a great time to sing that song. We'd sing Mansion Over the Hilltop and quite a number of other, Peace Like a River, and we'd get it going. I got peace like a river, I got peace like, and the kids would have fun. Fifth through eighth grade kids have a great time. So it was a lot of fun. Ted's in glory, but his impact in my life continues to this day. I worked with him as an apprentice in carpentry for years in high school and through college, and some of you guys have experienced the blessings of Ted working with me and on those things as well. And yet, he helped to impact my life through character and through his training. When we come to Acts chapter 2, we have some amazing things take place. And
I'm going to get rid of this coat because my little string on the back is pulling because I don't have it hooked up right. So I'm going to just plug it in the back because every time I move, it gets a little bit closer and this thing goes up to my nose. So I'd rather not just keep doing this and then you guys be hearing me breathe the whole time. So let's do it. We see some amazing things take place in Acts chapter 2. And the people that witnessed this wanted to know what in the world was going on. And in fact, in today's world, some people have a different interpretation on what took place in Acts chapter 2, and such that they want to repeat it and experience the same thing that the disciples did in that day. But as with anything in Scripture, you have to remember this. You have to interpret Scripture with what? Your feelings, right? No. You have to interpret Scripture with what is going on in the world, right? No. You interpret Scripture with what? Scripture. And you look at its context as well. Let's review a few things. In Acts chapter 1, verses 4 through 8, the Lord instructed the disciples to wait at Jerusalem for the promise of the Father. Amen? That's what he told them. And then he explained that they, in verse 5, that they would be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days hence, and that they would receive power to be a what? A witness. Catch that. That's important. They were going to receive power to be what? A witness for Christ. Just as the ministry of Jesus depended on the Holy Spirit descending on him, the ministry of the disciples depended on them receiving the Holy Spirit and relying on his power in their life. We also have here in Acts chapter 2 a special historical event. These individuals had just witnessed Jesus ascending into heaven. Amazing. Not only that, they saw Jesus risen from the grave. What a tremendous historical event that was. And now they're going to experience another historical event, where John 14, verse 26 came to be, where he says, Jesus says, "But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you." The Holy Spirit was going to come and empower them so that they could be a witness to the people around them. They could share God's word. The coming of the Holy Spirit signaled the way God would equip his church and his believers with his Spirit so that he could be glorified amongst the nations. You see, folks, the point of Pentecost is mission. And the goal of this mission is found in Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 14, where it says, "The earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea." Have you been down to the ocean lately? Down to the Gulf? Down to the Atlantic? And you look and you see as far as the eye can see, and the waters are there. Habakkuk 2:14 says, "As the waters cover the earth, the knowledge of the Lord is going to spread the earth." Let's read Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 11. It says here, "When the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues, as the Spirit gave them utterance. And there were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews, devout men, out of every," big important word, "nation under heaven. And when this was noised abroad, the multitude came together, and they were confounded, because that every man," what? "Heard them speak in their own language. And they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, Behold, are not all these which speak Galileans? And how hear we every man in our own tongue, wherein we were born?
Parthians and Medes, the Elamites, the dwellers of Mesopotamia, Judah, Cappadocia, Pontus, Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, and Egypt, and all parts of Libya and about Cyrene, strangers in Rome, and Jews and proselytes, Cretes and Arabians, we do hear them speak in our tongues. What? The wonderful works of God. I want to point out a few things that stand out in these verses. First of all, this passage reveals how God planned His church to take the gospel to the world and bring glory to this name. To kind of understand this event, we have to understand what was taking place. The Jewish feast of Pentecost. It was not by coincidence that God poured out His Spirit on His disciples that day. The day of Pentecost was an annual Jewish feast that was held in Jerusalem. It was the most likely attended feast out of the year. Three times a year they get together. And this was one of the feasts. And on that day, the day of Pentecost, the first loaves made from the wheat harvest were offered to the Lord. They were lifting praise to the Lord for His provision. It's kind of like Thanksgiving. We get all together, go back a few months, back to Thanksgiving time. What was filling the church? We'd have fruit. Some of all these different squash and stuff like that. And people would say, hey, I got this, that, and the other thing. Here's some extra stuff. And it was just like a bountiful harvest. Well, that's what was going on. Warren Wiersbe points out this. And this is important. Pentecost was 50 days later. 7 weeks plus one day. Then Pentecost took place on the first day of the week. It was 50 days after Jesus rose from the grave. 40 days He was here on earth. 10 days after He risen, we have the day of Pentecost. Until this time, the Lord's people consisted of Israel, just with a few Gentile proselytes. But now, the Lord formed the body of His church, made up of the Jews and Gentiles on equal footing. Paul calls this inclusion of the Gentiles into the church like a mystery in Ephesians chapter 3. And it was typified in the two loaves that they would hold up at the feast of Pentecost. These two loaves were made up of leavened bread, and they pictured the fact that although we are redeemed in Christ, we are still sinners who must learn to get along with those who in the flesh might be very different than we are. In Matthew chapter 16, verse 18, the Lord said to Peter, He said, upon this rock I'm going to build my church, upon this faith, upon this testament, upon this apostolic, this confession, this witness of Christ. I'm going to build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. We need to remember that our purpose as the Lord's church is not to focus on ourselves and our own happiness, but our purpose is to spread and to share the gospel, beginning in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. If we lose our outward focus, the overall purpose of God's glory, we have lost our reason for existence. So he points out the fact here that God planned His church to take the gospel to the world and bring glory to His name. The second point I want to point out here from this passage reveals that God's plan is for everyone, which means all nations. All nations. Luke lists out some nations in verses 9 through 11. And some of them we might recognize, and others we might say, what are those? All right. But it represents all the nations that were represented there at Pentecost. The key is this in verse number 5, where he says, there was people dwelling from every nation under heaven. These people that had come to Pentecost came from all over the world. They had not heard what had taken place because there was no Twitter. There was no Facebook. There was no CNN. There was no Fox News. There was no, you name it, taking place. They came together. They were devout people. They were God-fearing individuals. And they had made this pilgrimage,
I was going to say privilege, pilgrimage, okay, to Jerusalem for this feast. But they did not know that their Messiah had come. And he had sacrificed his life. And they needed to know. The list of nations kind of reminds us of the list of nations in Genesis chapter 10. Remember where the people started to build the Tower of Babel. And they wanted to raise it to heaven so they could get close to God. And God did what? What did he do? He confounded them and made them start to talk in different tongues. Different languages. Now, how many of you know a second language? Raise your hand. What language do you know, Matthew?
Spanish.
Can you say some Spanish stuff to us today? Go ahead.
Amo Dios.
I have no idea what he just said. Does anybody know what he just said? What did you just say, Matthew?
I love God.
You what?
I love God.
You love dog?
God.
God, okay. I love God, okay. I know cum esta, vin, si gracias, and where's the bonos, okay? Where's the bathroom at, okay? All right, I learned that when I was in Miami. That was about it. Now, if you ask me to do anything else, that's... I don't know anything else. That's about all I know. All right? God turned the confusion of languages into a miracle, a miraculous speech, and resulted in great blessing that day. The gift of speaking in tongues was granted that day, and it was a special miracle to demonstrate God's purpose in taking the gospel to all nations. I'm not gifted in another language, okay? Jeffrey and Sydney, they studied another language to take the gospel to the individuals that were there. And we just had Raymond Villanueva here, and he talked in whatever dialect he talks about in the Philippines. And we don't understand, but they are gifted with that. Folks, that's God's plan to take the gospel to all nations. The gospel is supposed to be taken everywhere. In Revelation chapter 5, verse 9, says, Jesus purchased for God with his blood men from every tribe and tongue and people and nation. The purpose of some of the miracles that took place that day at Pentecost was to spread the gospel and share the good tidings of Jesus Christ. I don't know about you folks, but I have been in a hospital room. I have been in a couple of other places, and I've taken God's word, and I've opened to them in the English language, okay? And shared with them the wonderful news of God's word. And it's just amazing to see what God does. Some of you have done that as well. That's our purpose. You have been gifted to speak in maybe two languages, or maybe one. Okay, maybe we don't speak too good in that either, okay? But you can share the gospel, amen? You can, that's a great place to say amen. Amen? Yes, we can share God's word. We cannot rest until all the nations have heard the good news about Christ. And what's something unique about this, folks? Well, we lived in Miami. We worked at a college that was in the area there, university. And it was, what, Florida International University, okay? And we would go up there once a week, and Campus Bible Fellowship would be on campus there. And we went and helped them out. You know what they did? They spent time sharing God's word with the individuals that would come from all over the world and study in America. And they would see these individuals come to trust Christ as their Savior. And then what would they do? They'd finish up their education, and where would they go? They'd go right back to their homes and share God's word. We have a unique thing going on in America today. We have people from all walks of life coming to America. And we have the responsibility to do what? Take the gospel to them. Amen? Maybe God has not called you to go to a foreign nation. But he has called you to be a testimony, a witness to him here where you're at. That's something we cannot miss. Thirdly, our passage points out that the Holy Spirit is key to fulfilling God's plan. I want you to understand this. The Holy Spirit is not just a force. He is the third person of the Trinity. He is God in every way. We know that he is a personal being because in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30, he can be grieved. He can be disappointed. Have you ever been disappointed by somebody in your life? I have. I've disappointed many people, I'm sure. All right. A number of them when I was coaching, okay, because their parents would sit up in the stands, okay? All right. Listen, we can grieve the Holy Spirit. Ephesians 4 tells us. We can grieve the Holy Spirit. Jesus calls him the Comforter, which means the one that comes alongside to help. Some of you, this last week on Wednesday, I was in Havana and I had just made some visits and my cord is zipping around here and distracting people besides me. And, I went to one house. I said, my tire's looking low. I better pump that up. And so they had some air and pumped it up. And I went to Havana and stopped there and met with some individuals. And then I said, I'm going to check that tire again. It was flat as a doornail. The day my wife lets me drive her car, she gives me a flat tire. Isn't that amazing? She did it. She planned it out just that way. And guess what? Somebody came alongside and helped a preacher. It was Heath. We had a great time. Taking that thing off of there and everything else, it was good. Back on, I'm off my way. Listen, the Holy Spirit is a comforter, one that comes alongside you to help. Help you what? Be a witness. Be a testimony. We can grieve him. We know that he is God and that he performs deeds such as creation, which only God can do. And remember in Acts chapter 5 when Ananias and Sapphira, when Peter confronted them, he said, listen, you have not lied unto men, but unto God. He's talking about the Holy Spirit there. Before the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit empowered people for serving God, but he did not permanently dwell within them at all. Now, some of us may feel like the Holy Spirit doesn't live inside of us because he's there, but we don't give him the rule of our life as we ought to. In the upper room, Jesus told the disciples that he would send the Holy Spirit to be with them forever. John 14 says, you know him because he abides with you and will be in you. On the day of Pentecost, the disciples were baptized with the Holy Spirit in fulfillment of God's promise. We see this in Acts chapter 8. We also see this in Acts chapter 10 and in Acts chapter 19 with different groups of believers. When this was completed, anyone that trusted Christ as their Savior receives the Holy Spirit at the moment of salvation. Galatians chapter 3, verses 2 through 5 tells us that. Paul talks about in Romans chapter 8, verse 9, he says, you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. We see this in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 through 20. Paul was saying, hey, what? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is what? In you, which ye have of God, and you are not your own? You've been bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are his. You see, when you trusted Christ as your Savior, when you believe that Jesus died on the cross for your sins, when you believe that he was buried and rose again the third day, when you believe that he ascended into heaven, when you've trusted Christ as your Savior, the Holy Spirit resides within you. That's scripture.
Yes, the Holy Spirit came at Pentecost as God said He would. But as a believer, you have the Holy Spirit living within you from that moment of salvation. You see, baptism refers to being totally identified with the Spirit. All right? This baptism of the Spirit for these individuals was a special experience for them. But Paul said later on in 1 Corinthians, he said it was something that was a part of their life. If it was a special occurrence, then Paul wouldn't have said anything to these individuals here in 1 Corinthians. Folks, listen, it's an act of God on your behalf. Yes, it is a special experience when you trust Christ as your Savior, because your home changes from where? Damnation to heaven, and the Holy Spirit resides within you. However, in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 18, we are commanded to be filled with the Spirit. Now, when you turn on the TV later on this afternoon, if you do that, and you get to the game where there's a game going on, you're going to see some nuts running around, are you not? Okay? And I don't know if we have any nuts in here for the teams that are playing later on, but I know we have some other type of folks in here that are excited about teams in the area and that, okay? In fact, we can see some of those things in their life. And you know what? And when they get to play, I remember one night I was out hunting, not too far from one of these homes. And I was sitting out there as the sun was going down. And I think it was the Florida-Georgia game. Thank you, Leah, for laughing at me again. Because I could hear people hooting and hollering all the way out in the field from a little shack called the Scale House. I won't mention anybody else's names, all right? But I could clearly hear what they were yelling and hooting and hollering, okay? There was some excitement going on in their life, was there not? They were filled with the spirit of excitement about their team, correct? Listen, the Holy Spirit lives within you. But how often do we yield to the Holy Spirit and give Him control over our life such that He controls our words, our thoughts, our actions, the things that we do? Do you catch the difference? Ephesians 5 talks about being filled with the Spirit, means to be controlled by the Spirit. To be filled with the Spirit, we have to empty ourselves by confessing all known sin and dying to self, and we have to yield ourselves to walking in the Spirit. Galatians chapter 5, verse 16 says, if we walk in the Spirit, we will not fulfill the lusts of the flesh. If we walk in the Spirit, we're going to exemplify the fruits of the Spirit, which are what? Love, joy, peace, long-suffering. Galatians 5, 23. I've shared this with many times. Two choices on the shelf. Pleasing God or pleasing self. If self you choose, then you will lose. If God's your choice, you will rejoice. We are filled with the Holy Spirit at the moment of salvation. But we don't always yield to the Holy Spirit, do we? No, not at all. In fact, somebody cuts you off on the way to work, and you, that spirit of what? The flesh takes over, does it not? Okay, don't look at anybody in the church, please, please, please. You can think about it, but don't look at them, okay? Yes, when your team scores, that spirit of excitement, yes, woo, we're there. Folks, listen. You can walk in the Spirit and allow the Holy Spirit to control your words and your actions, your thoughts. This initial outpouring of the Spirit at Pentecost was marked by three symbolic occurrences. In verse number 2, Sherry pointed out as well, there was a mighty rushing wind, this invisible power. Then there was tongues of fire in verse 3 that were rested on each of them that were there.
And that fire symbolizes God's holy presence. Then in verse 4, we see they were speaking in foreign languages, which nobody had previously learned. It would have been like Lex starts talking in French. Do you know anything about French, Lex? Okay, he starts talking in French. All right, and so does Jeff, Joe Joyce, okay? And then Tap and Betty Joe, they start talking in Venezuelan, which is Spanish, most likely, okay? And then we've got people talking in all different forms. Chinese, they start talking like, and then we got Japanese, and then we've got all these other languages, and all of a sudden, oh my word. Not only can they speak their mother language, but they can speak in another language. For what purpose? Look at verses 7. And they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, behold, are they not Galileans? How hear we every man in our own tongue? Folks, they were given the gift of speaking in tongues and other languages, and the people that were there heard, just like we are hearing today. I've spoken through an interpreter, all right? And that's not easy. But God has gifted some individuals to take God's word to those that don't understand English so that they can hear the glorious gospel of God. They spoke and the people understood. It was there to spread the gospel of the Lord. It's apparent that God granted his people their special gifts and abilities, not only to spread God's word, but to affirm the apostolic witness. And as we look at this even further, as we go through the book of Acts, you're going to find out that these gifts and abilities faded over time. Because the writer of Hebrews says, he wrote to a second generation group of Jewish Christians, and he tells them how the word of God was confirmed by the apostles through various miracles and the gifts of the Holy Spirit according to his own will. If those gifts were present in the church, he wouldn't have had to say, hey, this was what took place. Time gone by. The purpose of those gifts have been confirmed to confirm the apostolic message. And after the purpose was fulfilled, they passed off the scene. Folks, listen. The Holy Spirit lives within you and I. The last item that stands out is God was to be glorified in the nations. Every nation that was there in Jerusalem heard the glorious works of God in their own language. And guess what happened? Miraculous things took place. Peter spoke in the next chapter, and 3,000 people trusted Christ as their Savior. That's bigger than Calvary. 3,000 people trusted Christ as their Savior. Amazing. And it was that God could be glorified in the nations. So how do we apply this to our life? God's purpose at Pentecost was to equip his church with the power of the Holy Spirit so that we could be a witness to all nations. You've got to stop and sit and think about that. Some of you have not been gifted in a foreign language, but you have been gifted in speaking English. Are we being faithful at carrying God's message and giving glory to God in our own language? I was driving some kids home Wednesday night, dropping them off near Publix by our house in Tallahassee, and I heard a young man using some language. I didn't know what the words meant yet. Tripping and some of these other things, and I was like, man, what does that mean? You know? And I didn't understand that language yet, okay? Listen, you understand God's word. You can take God's word and love to those that are around you. Can you not? That Holy Spirit that lives within you, that resides within you, is there to help equip you to share the gospel through love, care, and just being Christ-like in your life. My question to you is this: are you being faithful to God in the language that you do know? Some of those believers in the upper room probably didn't get another language, okay? Because God intended them to speak right there to people of their own language. Folks, the second question I want to ask you is this: are you yielding your heart to the Spirit of God? Are you spending time in God's Word? Are you spending time yielding yourself to Him? Are you putting off and putting on those things that need to be put off in your life and put on? Every one of us has the Holy Spirit living within us. But not every one of us is filled with the Holy Spirit and walking and talking with Him as we ought. Heads bowed, eyes closed. Father, thank You for Your wonderful gift of the Holy Spirit. Thank You so very much for the Comforter that comes alongside of us to guide us into all truth. Father, thank You that we can yield to You and yield to Your Spirit. And Your Spirit, as we yield to You, You will control our thoughts, our words, and our actions. With heads bowed and eyes closed, what's God speaking to your heart today? What's God challenging your heart with? Maybe you know Christ as your Savior. Maybe there's some things in your life that you just need to yield to Him. Maybe there's an area in your life that you just need to give to the Lord. Maybe there's an area in your life where you just need to let have the Spirit take control. Sometimes we get so wound up with the relationships around us, the people around us, the problems at school, the problems in the neighborhood, the problems, you name it, at work. And we get distracted. And we just need to turn and focus on Jesus. Lord, take me and use me. Those individuals in the upper room were willing to be used. Are you willing to be used today? Father, challenge our hearts through Your Word. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand together and let's sing this hymn of invitation. If God's worked on your heart, I would ask that you'd come as we sing this morning. Thank You for Your Spirit. Thank You for Your love that You've bestowed upon us, such that You are with us each in every moment of the day. Help us as individuals to step forward and demonstrate in our words, in our actions, in the way we interact with others, the loving character of the Holy Spirit that lives within us. Father, if we demonstrated that to those around us, it would change our world and open up avenues for us to share your word. Help us to be faithful. Help us to focus on you this week. I know the message ends, but God's heart of conviction will follow you outside this doors. Work on our hearts this week. In Jesus' name, amen.